make 5 points, they are rather bullet points, they're staccato, because a short address, that's fine. And then I hope you will come back with questions for us or comments. First, something about the Conference of European Churches. The conference is comprised of sort of Anglican, Protestant, and Orthodox churches all over Europe, wider than the EU. It is, of course, from churches from the EU, but wider. Significant member is the Serbian Orthodox Church, for example, which is not, certainly not, of course, not getting part of the EU. And the concern for freedom of religion and belief for everyone is in the DNA, in the makeup of the Conference of European Churches, because we were founded in the times of the Cold War, when the issue of religious freedom in the Eastern Bloc was a huge issue for the martyrs and confessors, clergy, ministers, pastors, and lay people witnessing to their faith. We believe in the promotion and protection of all human rights and freedom of religion belief for every human being, nation, people, culture. Now, with the end of the divisions of the old Europe, it was supposed that there would be less need for vigilance with regard to human rights and freedom of religion. Tragically, this is not the case. Your working group illustrates that and knows that very well. The situation is getting worse rather than better. Deep within the central doctrines of Christianity, and even more so within the faith beliefs of the three monotheistic religions, faiths, the Abrahamic tradition, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, are to be found the origins of what we now call human rights. Remember the story in the book of Genesis. Abraham recognized in the face of the three strangers the very face of God. One stranger. Now, the Enlightenment, the European and Western European Enlightenment, developed the concept of human rights, but did not invent them. Genesis teaches us, a common book to the three Abrahamic faiths, common sacred scriptures, that all human beings are created and made in the image and likeness of God. That gives every human being a value. Specifically Christian, classical teacher from the early days of the Christian church, St. Athanasius taught, Athanasius of Alexandria, taught that God became human so that humans might become God's kind of divine transaction. All human rights for Christians, and for the conference, and all duties, our duties which stem from our rights, come from this basic conviction. So the Conference of European Churches advocates not just for Christian churches, Christian individuals, but equally for all. And in that, we have common cause with your particular group. If we forget that every human being is created in God's image and likeness, then we have failed in our specifically Christian vocation. One final comment on the Conference of European Churches. We work very closely indeed with the Catholic Church, and particularly with the office in Brussels, which is called Commissae, that is the Commission of Bishops' Conferences of the EU, Episcopal Conference of the Catholic Church. So we have a very close working relationship. Pat Daly is their director, and Cardinal Marx of Munich is their chairman. And we have regular work together. If you look at the EU guidelines for the protection of freedom of religious belief, 2013, very recent, 2013, Guidelines, Protection of Freedom of Religious Belief. KEC, that's the Conference of European Churches, KEC, and COMESEC, the Catholic equivalent office in Brussels, worked together, hand in hand, a joint presentation, and the results are found in that EU document. So that's a little bit about my background. Second point is very different. You are concerned for global freedom of religion and religious belief. And so I take just one global example, which I have some personal experience of. We're going to hear a little bit about Egypt. I take you now to another part of Africa, to Nigeria. When I was Bishop of Guildford in the United Kingdom, our diocese of Guildford was linked with eight Anglican dioceses, eight or nine Anglican dioceses throughout Nigeria. And I have made four extensive visits to Nigeria in the recent past, in the last 8 years. On one visit, I was in Plateau Province, which those of you who know, Nigeria is in the middle where the north and south meet. The northern largely Muslim areas and the southern largely Christian areas. Jos is the state capital. In Jos, with the local Anglican bishop, I saw a recently burnt out church, more than one, but this is one in particular. I visited a burnt out shopping precinct, which was a largely Christian neighborhood. And the story there was very interesting. I met some of the local inhabitants. They now had their no more shops or houses. They were staying with friends elsewhere. And the precinct had been burnt out about 2 months before I was there. Their Muslim neighbors came round to their Christian neighbors in the shops and the apartments, flats, and said, get out quickly. People from outside, that was the Muslim neighbors' words about people from outside, are coming tonight, and it'd be safer if you're not in your house. They stepped out, and the shops and the houses were burnt down. On another visit to Nigeria, I went to as far as Lake Chad, which is geographically almost in the middle of the great African continent. I sailed in a little fishing dinghy, not much longer than the first table here, with an outboard motor, on Lake Chad. It's a sadly polluted lake now, and it's getting more polluted and will eventually be a dead sea. What that will do to the animals around it, which depend upon fishing for their livelihood, who can tell. So I visited Lake Chad. On my last visit to that part of Nigeria, I was not allowed to go there. When I visited the first time, I visited three new little Anglican churches, about 100 to 200 in each, tin corrugated iron sheds of the churches, different townships, which were fishing townships. Those have all gone. Most of those townships are burnt out, and the story again is people from over the lake, coming crossing the lake from outside, came and Boko Haram and destruction of the communities. It also goes for some Pentecostal communities and some Catholic communities. The state of Maiduguri is more or less destroyed. So I could not go there, and those communities are no more. The priest I saw, I believe, had fled, was not killed, but everybody had to get out or die. That's just one global example. I have some personal experience. I will now turn, I'll try to keep my 10 minutes, briefly to Europe. In some countries, the member churches of KEK, particularly in the Western Balkans, admittedly with a very hard post-communist situation, with a harsh regime, there are still some difficulties over not persecution but religious freedom questions. And your chairman has already referred to the developing situation in Russia. I paid a visit recently to the Ukraine. I went a little to the east, but it's not easy to go there. But I do know about the situation in Crimea, which now comes under Russian law and the imposition of rules and regulations which only recognise one church, the Russian Orthodox Church. And there have been some expulsions, some Catholic nuns have had to move. No toleration, of course, of the Ukrainian Orthodox Church, the independent Orthodox Church, etc. So there are different issues. But we can also sympathise from the KEK of some Islamic communities. For example, in Austria, a new law last year which would not allow the Austrian Muslim communities to receive any external funding from outside. Now, we know that external funding can be used to fund extremist things, but a blanket refusal for support from outside Austria seems to be, to me, to also be violating religious rights. Popular prejudice now can take the form of Islamophobia, we know that, or a toxic revival of anti-Semitism in many parts of Europe. Not just in, for example, France. I know in Manchester, Birmingham and London, serious anti-Semitic revival. And criticisms very much of populist criticisms of, which are amount to Islamophobia. Populist opposition and anxiety about immigration has been a major factor in the UK referendum, as you're well aware, the Brexit decision. But that's also the case in the local elections in Germany just recently. Two final points. I want to just flag the issue of secularist, I don't mean secular, but secularist opposition to practice of religious belief in the public square. That can be an issue in Western European countries, in the UK. More serious, I think, is the question of religious illiteracy, particularly at junior official level. I cite a specific example from the UK. In the lower courts of asylum cases, the scrutiny of those who have converted from Islam to Christianity are scrutinised by a commercial company with very little true religious knowledge. They get taken to an appeal court, which is very costly and expensive, and almost all of those decisions have been overturned. So we have a situation where religious illiteracy, that's not the only example. I want to finally say that there is something very practical that we could do in Europe through the European institutions, and that's, like the US, to not only monitor religious freedom questions, but to record them with an annual report on countries in the EU and outside the EU. This happens with the Department of State Department, which you're unaware of, I think you'll be in the group. The Conference of the European Churches had a consultation in Istanbul last year, hosted by the Ecumenical Patriarchate and the Parish Church, a number of resolutions, but that one, a very practical one. When reports are produced and they are monitored and stated, there is then a good way of taking appropriate civil and political action and drawing the attention of authorities to abuses or potential abuses. I thank you for your patience. I'm very happy shortly after the other presentations to take any questions or comments. Thank you.